But I think it's very complex we are discussing actually. And co-infections, I think it's the wrong word, but we could discuss also later why I think it's the wrong word to name it co-infection. We have Borrelia burgdorferi. It's really worldwide endemic, going up to epidemic. We have the Babesia infections. We have the Bartonella infections. We have the Ehrlichia. These are all bacteria in the ticks. So then we name it tick-borne diseases, tick-borne pathogens. Chlamydia is also in the ticks. That could surprise you. Rickettsia is in the ticks. Coxiella is in the ticks. Mycoplasma was also found in ticks. So we can say now these are all tick-borne diseases, and it can cause other symptoms, other infections by this bacteria. About viruses, we don't know. A friend of mine, Dietrich Klinghardt, said in one presentation together, he named it opportunistic infections. I think it makes sense, maybe an HIV model to build up with the opportunistic infections in this complexity. I want to start with the Ehrlichia anaplasma. Professor Puri, pretty well done the sentence. They are all intracellular. All we are discussing are intracellular. They don't exist extracellular. The only bacteria extracellular is Borrelia burgdorferi. Nothing else. All other bacteria in the cells. So for the treatment, you have to think also in this direction. And this Ehrlichia is also in the ticks. Up to 8% of the ticks are contaminated with Ehrlichia anaplasma. What about the symptoms? It begins with a rapid onset of illness with fever, headache, prostration. Headaches are sharp, knife-like, and often located behind the eyes. In the morning, I had this symptom. I had some headache. I had exactly that symptoms, maybe Ehrlichia infection. Muscle pain, not joint pain, neurological symptoms. And always the problem is the immune system. If you have a very weak immune system, also nutrition plays a very important role in this field. If the immune system is weakened, you are, can get very easy such an infection. And it can be reactivated also. I think many of the infections are also immune controlled, like we control herpes, EBV, for example, or varicella zoster. The Ehrlichia diagnosis could be done by the ELISpot. That's a very worthful test. You will find a lot of patients with musculoskeletal symptoms, rheumatoid arthritis, fibromyalgia, with Ehrlichia infections. In Germany, there's a study in Ulm. Professor Kratsch did it with his rheumatoid arthritis patient. 30% had Ehrlichia infections, 30% of rheumatoid arthritis patients in his group, and Borrelia together. You could try a PCR in the bloodstream. You could do a Giemsa blood smear, and the antibodies are also you could do to screen for antibodies. And elevated liver enzymes and leukopenia, they are these are indirect signs. I don't want to talk about so much about herbal therapies because I'm traditional school medicine man coming from university, no herbalist. I'm not so experienced in this field. But from the antibiotics, you should use azithromycin or clarithromycin, doxycycline or minocycline, ciprofloxacin, levofloxacin, and rifampicin. Rifampin could be possible, but be careful during pregnancies. The next bacteria, the next co-infection is Babesia co-infection. We have also several subspecies of Babesia. It's Microti, it's our European subspecies. The divergence in USA, they have the WA1 subspecies. Also, when a patient got sick in USA, you have to look for Babesia WA1. The Babesia is like malaria. You got a malaria infection. You got fever. You got night sweat during 2 and 4 o'clock after midnight. You got bad sweating that night. What does it do? It's malaria. A rapid onset of beginning illness with fever, headache. Then you have the sweats, night sweat. During day also you have fatigue. You have air hunger. You feel really sick. It's malaria-like infection. You have a dry cough and stiffness of neck, nausea. You have some tiredness, chronic fatigue syndrome, feeling of weakness, exhaustion, and so on and so on. And also very important, you have a risk factor if you have a splenectomy or immune suppression. It's very, very dangerous. In Australia, the first patient died by a blood transfusion some years ago, and Babesia was in the blood transfusion, and the government knows about the problem. So normally you should test all blood before the transfusion, before you give it to an immune-suppressed patient, an intensive care. So that's known also in USA. People die by this transfusion, and Babesia bacteria is in it, malaria is in it, so you can die. So please think of it, maybe testing in the future. Babesia does some hemangiomata. This is a picture from Australian patients. It also does some skin problems. This is a slide from Alan MacDonald also. The human babesiosis world map, it's spreading around and more and more and more and more. The climate's changing. Etc. And you see here in Australia also this endemic areas. We talk more about endemic situations, though Babesia is not everywhere. I think Borrelia is much bigger problem because 30 up to 40% of the ticks are contaminated with Borrelia, but just 3, 4, 5% endemically with Babesia. That's the difference. You can do the testing is a little more difficult. We don't have the ELISpot actually, but we could do a PCR, we could do a FISH. FISH is not a PCR, it's a special kind of direct test in the EDTA blood. We could try a blood smear, we could do the antibodies. This is what we do for Microti, and we have some other indirect signs in the blood. What about therapy? The therapy for Babesia is malaria therapy. So you use Malarone, Atovaquone, Lariam, Plaquenil. Plaquenil hydroxychloroquine is also very often used in Lyme therapies. So you also treat Babesia therapies. Or my favorite is more the Artemisia, Artemisinin, Artemisia annua. This is a nature product of a herb. So it's very helpful also in Babesia infections, and it's anti-inflammatory. Artemisia is one of the first choice medicine, I think, in infectious diseases the next years. Bartonella, Professor Puri talked about Bartonella. Bartonella is also intracellular in the endothelial cells and the erythrocytes, and it's, we all know it from the cat scratch surface wounds, and also it's in the ticks. In Germany, up in Europe, up to 40% of ticks are contaminated, up to 40% with Bartonella, but endemically. That means in the garden of your neighbor, there can be endemic area for Bartonella, but in the other garden of the other neighbor, nothing. It's really endemic in the garden or in the forest. So we have to look for hotspots. We need more and more hotspots, maps to do for Bartonella, for Borrelia, for Rickettsia, and all other infections. What about the symptoms? The symptoms are headache, tiredness, muscle problems, tremors, seizures, fever in the morning. You have some swollen lymph nodes, myalgia, neurological problems, depression, severe mood swings, lack of concentration. So many of the symptoms are overlapping the same symptoms you suffer from Lyme disease. So if a patient is tired, you cannot say, patient, you suffer from Borrelia infection, Lyme disease, or is it maybe a Bartonella infection? And then you need the laboratory. Therefore, I'm here. Or other laboratories like Argenics, not just me. You need laboratory behind this to find it out. You cannot. The symptom is not telling you the story. The diagnosis cannot be made just by the symptom, because the symptoms are all overlapping, many of them. Joe Borescano did another definition of Bartonella-like organism years ago with just minimal musculoskeletal symptoms, but I don't believe in this. But let's see what's coming out. These are the stria Professor Puri showed you. We see a lot of them. But believe me, many of the dermatologists, they don't think of Bartonella infections. They don't think of it. If they see such, they say it's some, you scratched some wound scratching or something like that. That could be also a cat scratching here and transmission by a cat, for example. That could be also, but you could do biopsy here and you could look for Bartonella by a PCR, by a pathologist. That could be also very good to diagnose it, to find Bartonella here in this area. You could try it. Why not? A good pathologist. So you could do the PCR, you could do the histology, it's named, you could do the antibodies for Hensele and Quintana. Quintana is another subspecies. And you could do the VAGF. It's very seldom increased, but it could be an activity marker. I know one laboratory in Germany doing this test and in USA. So the V could be also some interesting point. What about therapies for Bartonella? The Bartonella therapy is the same like for Ehrlichia. You use azithromycin, clarithromycin, just speaking about antibiotics, doxycycline, ciprofloxacin, etc. Ceftriaxone can be used against Bartonella infections. Rickettsia is number 4 now. Rickettsia is all over the world. The veterinarians, they know a lot about Rickettsia. We have in Germany 30 subspecies of Rickettsia. Rickettsia conori, Rickettsia rickettsii, Helvetica from Switzerland, Slovakia from Slovakia, Provaceae, we have so many. Also Southern Africa is full of, the ticks are full of Rickettsia, and Australia. So it's endemic in the world. And also very important, the travel anamnesis. You have to ask each patient, did you do some traveling to Australia before you got sick? That's very important, this question, to ask for travel anamnesis. If you don't do that, you miss a lot of information. And the complications of Rickettsia are not so nice. You could suffer from perimyocarditis. You could suffer from kidney insufficiencies, pneumonia, encephalitis, etc., etc. So it's very dangerous for your heart and also in the differential diagnosis with Borrelia burgdorferi infection. What could you do by laboratory? We could do Rickettsia rickettsii and conori IgM, IgG antibodies, so we could try PCR, but that's it. So we don't have the ELISA spot. I'm missing it, but hopefully next year it will come. Rickettsia therapy is doxycycline, tetracycline. It's also similar to all other co-infections. But you see the antibiotics are very restricted. We don't have 100 antibiotics to choose from, just let's say 10 or 12, that's all. And if you don't tolerate them or some of them, it's very difficult to find other antibiotics for you because they don't exist. There is no research on antibiotics, no research, absolute nothing, also for vector-borne diseases. That's my favorite, absolutely worldwide infection number one. It's chlamydia infection, pneumoniae. It's an airborne infection, human to humans, or reactivated in Lyme disease. That's very funny story. In Australia, they have hospitals for koalas. And the koalas, they are very sick by this chlamydia pneumonia infection. They are treated by the veterinarians, not by the humans. And they're lying in hospitals, and they all got antibiotics. And what does this do, this chlamydia pneumonia? That's very interesting. It's associated with Alzheimer's disease. It's associated with multiple sclerosis. It's associated with depression, with fibromyalgia, with ME, CFS, heart attacks, acute ischemic strokes, atherosclerosis, autism, very important in autistic children, Parkinsonism, rheumatoid arthritis, and others. So here we are similar to Borrelia's story. Oh, it's nearly the same spectrum. The symptoms are cough, very often cough, slight throat pain, hoarseness, sinusitis. It makes in a recent infection a typical pneumonia, myocarditis and the Guillain-Barré syndrome. Also, we should look in your group with the ALS, I think the ALS group. We should also look for chlamydia and mycoplasma in this group because it's so nearby. It's intracellular. It builds cystic pleomorphic forms, aberrant forms, they name it. It's just in the cells. And it's a biofilm producer, also biofilm. So it's exactly Borrelia's story. And who knows the book from Leider Mettmann? You know Leider Mettmann, very old book, The Stealth Phenomena from Leider Mettmann? No? It's on Amazon. The last books are going away now. It's a very good book about Leider Mettmann was nearly Nobel Prize winner 10 years ago in medicine. She's dead now, very famous in USA. And she described everything about chlamydia, biofilms, L-forms, cystic forms. And her hypothesis was that the bacteria, they all come from a very old, Professor Puri showed you the history of this bacteria, from an old form of bacteria, and it can change in your body in several other bacteria. It can go back and can develop in another form, you know? It can go to Borrelia form or Chlamydia form, Mycoplasma. That's hypothesis. The book is very, very interesting, and she hit the nail on the head by this book. If you read it, you say, I mean, you are right. What about the koalas then? Yeah, the koalas are treated. very successfully, but the park ranger is not. If a park ranger got chlamydia infection, no, you don't suffer from chlamydia. And they all got Alzheimer's disease, Parkinsonism, the koalas are treated. You know, they are lying in the trees snoring, and they're so tired, the koalas, and the park rangers too. The park ranger is also snoring there, but they got not treated, and they don't look for chlamydia. So that means veterinarians are one step in front of us. If you talk with veterinarians, one step in front of us, they know much more, and they accept it. It's accepted for a dog. Dogs can get very sick by chlamydia infection, and it can be also transmitted by a cough from a horse to a horse rider. It's very easy. It's the same bacteria, and you can get sick. Think of this, that's not hypothesis. Chlamydia pneumonia, that's very, very good. We have the ELI spot for it. I came to that point by Judith McGloshy years ago. She came to my laboratory and hospital, and she told me, Armin, in Alzheimer's disease, I found, and also L. McDonald, in Alzheimer's, they found Borrelia and chlamydia, both. Not just Borrelia, both. Both are responsible for Alzheimer's disease. There are a lot of literature behind, books. Nobody looked at it. There are very good books from the 90s about chlamydia. Chlamydia makes a lot of Alzheimer's, a lot of Parkinsonism. Chlamydia is everywhere around the world. How to find out now? We could do the ELI spot. It's very active by the ELI spot. And we could do the IgA antibodies. IgA is also fascinating. IgA, local standing antibody, half-life time, it's just 2 weeks. Also in the apoplectic stroke, you find 60% with chlamydia antibodies. That's very interesting, atherosclerosis discussion. Huh? PCR also might be possible. But what about therapies? Here we are, it's exactly the same therapy like for all co-infections. So every time the same therapy, azithromycin, clarithromycin, maybe use combination with rocephin, minocycline, very powerful, neurological symptoms, levofloxacin, metronidazole, also described, intracellular form, slime, what about that, also some questions. Mycoplasma is Garth Nicholson, is the prophet for mycoplasma infection, it's also in the ticks, it can be transmitted human to human, it makes tiredness, it makes fever, joint pain, swelling of joints, muscle pain, headache, all the symptoms, Borrelia, chlamydia, nearly all the same. Or, yes, Babesia, Rickettsia, we are talking about the same symptoms, so we are nearby. Differential diagnosis, although the Gulf War I syndrome, very important, and autism. Mycoplasma plays a very important role in autism in children. What about laboratory tests? We could do the antibodies. We don't have the ELI spot. I was asked so very often, but we don't have the ELI spot for it. Sorry. I'm not the test producer. They have to produce. We need the antigen. If you know somebody who could deliver a lot of antigens for the test producers, they will do the ELI spot. I ask them. We do exactly the same therapy like for chlamydia, like for rickettsia. It's like Borrelia. It's the same therapy. So we just discuss about one thing. I cannot go into all others, Yersinia, herpes, CMV, toxoplasma, HHV6, HHV8, Coxsackie, but you have Judith Mikowitz afterwards, she's an expert in the viruses. So, Armin, how to find out which infection in which patient? That was a question. Joe Boroscano is very fit, and I developed here this co-infection checklist some years ago. This, you could get it for free for your patient, it's very easy done. Patients filling out here the co-infections, which are symptoms, no, the symptoms. Patients, for example, stomach ache, anemia, diarrhea, fever, just crossing. Each patient is a little bit different from the other. And then I developed this evaluation template. It's here for doctors, not for the patients or therapists. And I will show you now a practical example what's coming out. It was a Spanish patient. This patient had stomach ache. This patient had fever, feverish feeling. This patient had lack of concentration, memory disturbance, forgetfulness, yellowish color of the skin, painful joints, general aches and pain, flu-like symptoms, also heart problems, headache and fatigue, exhaustion, chronic fatigue syndrome, muscle pain, shivering and nausea, dark urine. It was a Spanish patient. So that are the symptoms, and by my co-infection checklist, I found out 8 symptoms for chlamydia pneumonia, position one, it's here. How many symptoms for mycoplasma? 7 symptoms for mycoplasma, 7 symptoms for Coxsackie virus, it's enterovirus complex, then 6 symptoms for Bartonella, for Rickettsia it was here 5 symptoms, position 4. Then you get a ranking, and it's from patient to patient a little bit different. So, but favorite number one is here in the middle. I did now the laboratory for this Spanish patient according to this co-infection checklist. It was done by Dr. Mariano Bueno from Zaragoza, taking the blood. That was not a question for Lyme. That was a question Lyme plus more than Lyme, co-infection, multiple infection, opportunistic infection. Well, what's the reason for all of the symptoms? And I found the IgG antibody. Also, look here, the ELISA found it. And the IgG immunoplot was positive. VLSE, very important, was positive. And there was a corresponding activity in the fully antigen and the peptide mix for Borrelia illispot. So that means actual activity against Borrelia burgdorferi, or recent activity against Borrelia burgdorferi. But also, that patient had a very high IgA titer for Yersinia, also Yersinia activity, Yersinia sign infection. The Yersinia illispot was plus 20, also very high result for Yersinia activity in this body, in this patient. And then Chlamydia also was high, the IgA 3.5 ratio, that was more than high. The corresponding, the LTT was high, 18 stimulation indices, that means a recent activity against Chlamydia and Yersinia by laboratory. And also IgA production for mycoplasma was high, so a sign for active mycoplasma infection. Also cytomegalovirus was not so high, it was just 4, the stimulation index. And Coxsackie virus was also high, 1 to 100 IgA. Also Rickettsia, IgG antibodies. EBV activity by the lytic antigen 17, active EBV infection too. And the CD57 count was low, 37 per microliter. So you could ask me, which infection does now the low CD57 count? Is Borrelia or what is it? I cannot tell you in this case, because this patient had 5 bacteria infection and 3 viruses. He didn't know that. He didn't know that over years. It was a catastrophe. So by my co-infection checklist, by this checklist, it was suspicious for Borrelia infection, Chlamydia infection, Mycoplasma infection, Coxsackie virus infection, EBV infection, Rickettsia and Yersinia infection. And exactly that came out by the tests. Exactly that situation. So the prediction is very, very high. Not each patient, sorry to say that was extremely, really extremely sick patient. But that means you have to look for each infection by laboratory test, not all by this ranking. That makes sense to spare money for patient. My next project was to look the correlation of modern laboratory tests for Borrelia burgdorferi and Chlamydia infections, and I found out that the correlation of Borrelia and Chlamydia was a very high one. So we have in 80% of all Borrelia infections, we have problems with Chlamydia infections too. The therapy options now, just a short, I'm now not the specialist for therapies, I know a little about it. I'm a fan of modular therapy concepts, antibiotics, nutrition, anti-inflammatory, nutritional supplements, pain therapy, complementary therapies, naturopathy, homeopathy, biological medicine. There are lots, Samento, Kumanda, Noni, Banderol, Takuna, Tiesel, Ketzler, Artemisia, Resveratrol, and Gravis, garlic, etc., etc. The list is full. If you go to functional conferences, you see fish oils, omega-3, fatty acids. I think it's very difficult to find out the best concept in this lot of test producers of therapies. Rehabilitation, exercise therapy, it's very important. Stress management, very important. Relaxation, mental coaching, change of lifestyle. What are the aims and goals of therapies? Patients want that the bacteria or viruses, they should be destroyed. For example, antibiotics, you should do combination of bacteriostatic and bactericide antibiotics. Consider, please, the different structures of bacteria or viruses, pleomorphic forms, biofilms, intracellular forms, L-forms, cystic forms, round bodies, and diagnose co-infections for the right selection of therapies. First, you have to find out the enemy in the body, and then then you treat this enemy. It must not be a Borrelia infection. It could be just a single Rickettsia infection, but you have to know it. Otherwise, you stuck on Borrelia, Borrelia, Borrelia. And I think the truth is in the middle. Borrelia is misdiagnosed a lot, but it's also overdiagnosed because a lot of colleagues, they don't know about this multiple or other infections. It's infectiology we are doing here, and it's not so easy to understand for me too. Sufficiently long treatment. Don't treat a patient just 2 weeks and say that's all and that's your fate. Treat a patient such a long time you think it's necessary and the patient is improving, but don't treat for 10 years with the same antibiotics and nothing happens. So that's also risk-benefit ratio. The risk-benefit ratio for the side effects of oral antibiotics, this from Ray Stricker study, it's 1 to 1 million or 4 of 10,000. For infusion, it's 1 of 100,000 up to 3 to 10,000. So the risk for antibiotics is also minimal, but be careful in using antibiotics without knowing what you're aiming to. If you have a Babesia infection, antibiotics are not helpful. You need an anti-malaria remedy and therapy. If you have some virus infection, also it's contraindicated if you have a EBV infection. So be very, very careful. So this is a summary from my experience, which antibiotics you can choose for Borrelia, Chlamydia, and Mycoplasma. You can use the microlides, macrolides, you can use the doxycycline, minocycline, you can use the metronidazole, you can use cephalosporins, remedies that have an intracellular action, that's a big problem in my eyes, hydroxychloroquine, Artemisia annua, artemisinin. Viruses also very difficult to treat. We have the Delimune we use successful in Germany, the immune modulation, herbal products for biofilm, serapeptase, lumpropinase. Go back, you know the biofilms also, you need some options. In the stage one of a recent infection, we use doxycycline, and doxycycline is helpful also against Ehrlichia, I told you before, but don't treat a patient just 2 weeks. Treat a patient 4 weeks, maybe longer, until everything has gone, the bullseye rash has to vanish, and no control is afterwards. They just give the doctor 7 days doxycycline, no control afterwards. That's not good. You produce chronic cases by that. Also, you have to treat pregnant women and children, but you cannot use doxycycline. You can use cefuroxim, amoxicillin, for example. So this is an example for antibiotic strategy. You could use azithromycin, for example. You combine it with doxycycline or minocycline. You could combine it then with another hydroxychloroquine if you want, or you use Artemisia annua. And you can use also metronidazole. Metronidazole is a very hard therapy also for the liver. So the way is more and more combination therapies, not just one single antibiotics. A whole body concept should be done. You should improve the compatibility and effectiveness of the antibiotics, strengthen the immune system, relieve pain therapies, produce bad conditions for the bacteria and viruses, though you inhibit the reproduction of bacteria, mobilize hidden Borrelia in cystic forms or pleomorphic forms in the connective tissue, very problematic to reach there by therapies, reduce inflammation, cytokine storm, and balance TH1, TH2 system, treat anxiety, depression, concentration problems, etc. Support the organ system, liver, kidney, intestines, heart, brain, detoxify, that's also, I'm no expert in this, improve overall capacity, muscle power. Myers cocktail is a good opportunity. It was developed by John Myers from Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore. It's a combination, very powerful infusion therapy by vitamins C, high concentrated B1, B6, B12. It's very helpful to bring up the immune system because the immune system is the key. It's always the key, the immune system. It's the immune-triggered diseases we are talking about today. So, naturopathy, it's just an example for the Lee Cowden protocol. I know, and I have recommended also some doctors or naturopaths. In some cases, it's an option for it's Samento, Comanda, Quina, Takuna against viruses, Noni, Bandrol, Berberi, Glucane, Procaine, and Melatonin is also used, DHEA, Selene, Zinc. I'm no expert in this. That's the job of the people here, the therapist. But you have to do balance of the TH1 and TH2 system. system. That's very important in my eyes. And the autonomic nerve system, it's adrenal stress. I'm also not the expert in it, but I want just to show you a little where the way could go in the next years. It's also to support the stressing factors. Yeah, and the herbal support for the adrenal fatigue could be Schisandra, Astralagus, Rhodentrum, Ginseng, for example, in Germany, Rhodiola. We use Amantilla, for example, and to close it now, therapies, very interesting workshop. I'm no therapist, but I know a lot of therapy options. It has to be individualized for your patients, and to come to an end, Dr. Joosten from Radboud University, Netherlands, he was asked also, if you believe in chronic Lyme disease, what do you believe are the most effective ways to treat it? If chronic or persistent Lyme disease exists, very careful sentence, we will need more than antibiotics for treatment. That's a scientific guide. Anti-inflammatory components or anti-cytokine treatment will be options. And I think exactly that's the right way. So summary and conclusion. Sensitivity of ELISA in chronic Lyme disease is just up to 42%, according a lot of studies. Sensitivity of immunoblot is just around 60%. It's better than nothing. ELISA tests are too insensitive and useless. Throw it away, actually, or forget it. Negative antibodies in the immunoblot cannot exclude Lyme disease. That's a takeaway message for the doctors. IgM antibody persistence is a sign of for chronic Lyme disease. There is a possibility of false negative CSF results. Don't believe the neurologist and the laboratory there. 86% of chronic patients with chronic Lyme are co-infected with chlamydia. What's the dominant infection? I think chlamydia is harder to treat than Borrelia, much harder. I see it by my ELISpot results, but you will get some data from me. I'm working on it. Borrelia or chlamydia mycoplasma symptoms are not highly specific. We have overlapping symptoms. Symptoms are similar or the same. Patients can be co-infected by other bacteria in the tick, Babesia, Bartonella, Rickettsia, Ehrlichia anaplasma. You can do a ranking of the co-infections by the modern co-infection checklist. You should do a staging of Lyme disease and co-infections by modern laboratory tests, established tests, actually recombinant immunoblots, VLSE, ELISpot, CD57. Multiple infections with Borrelia, Chlamydia, and Mycoplasma very often are the reason. They are the reason for ME and CFS, multiple sclerosis, ALS, Parkinsonism, dementia, fibromyalgia, rheumatoid arthritis, autism, apoplectic strokes, heart attacks. Give preference to antibiotics that have intracellular action. We have just a few of them. Use combinations of antibiotics, make macrolides like azithromycin, doxycycline, the combination with tetracyclines, artemisia. Use additional therapies against biofilms and no antibiotics without probiotics. And thank you very much for your attention.